And so the topic that we are going to analyze today is the idea of stunts. And so first of all, I would like to thank a lot the people that are organizing this event with me all the time. One is Daniela Silvestrin and the other Kim Foss. And thank you again for your wonderful work. And we will go on with long nights of presentations, and then I will also come back in stage, on stage to discuss a bit what we did this year. That has been actually a really exciting year. And for that, I want, first of all, to thank the Hauptstadt Kulturfonds, that is our main funders, and our main cooperation partner, the Kunstankreuzberg Bethanien and Stefan Bauer. And this time also we have some partner that we are collaborating. All the time at the Disruption Lab we have new network connections that take place. And in these specific events I thank Forterfield, that has been also our media partner for the whole year, and Ruth Catlow will be here later moderating the second panel, so actually thank you for that, and also thank you for this great collaboration that started already at the first event when we spoke about drones, and there was with us Mark Garrett, that is the other co-founder of Forterfield, so thanks a lot for that. And also we have a cooperation with the Spectrum, and I see Lieke on the public, and I want really to thank her too. And this night we will conclude our Disruption year having a party at their wonderful space in Kreuzberg, so I invite you all to come when it will be 10 o'clock, we will be all there. And our third cooperation partner for this time is the Axioma Institute of Contemporary Art with Janne Zianza, that unfortunately could not be here today, but they are somehow present because we did a great collaboration by producing a catalog that I will also introduce at the end of today. So, and actually there is another group that I want to thank, is the Chelsea Manning Initiative, and they are the people that are being outside doing these wonderful stunts of projection, and they have also a table over there with the information about Chelsea Manning, and so these days are really important because the 17th of December will be the birthday of Chelsea Manning. She will turn 28, and is actually her sixth birthday in prison. So I think, I mean, actually there is not so much to celebrate in that sense, but we want to be close to her and also, in a sense, have her here with us by doing an info point. So thanks a lot also to the Chelsea Manning Initiative. And finally, also our media partners, Taz, ex-Berliner, and again, Forterfield. So now I don't want to speak for half an hour, and I want to go into the topic of this night, that is stunts, distributed, playful, and disruptive. And if you want, it's also a bit the concluding topic for this round of conferences that we had this year of the Disruption Network Club. And the idea is to speak about political stunts, data dumps, interventions, pranks, and viralities. And if we speak about political stunts, we could define them as the act of exposing control mechanisms that can affect institutions and media corporations. And also, a stance, a political stance, is a moment in which it's possible to reveal social injustices or misconducts of corporation or agency, and also, you know, controlling mechanism. And in that sense, we also want to discuss how this moment of exposure can also become an artistic practice. So we will have today really great crowds of disruptors, viral, imaginary thinkers, and the people that really know a lot about how to make a change and to make it unexpected. And also at the same time, also how to disrupt the systems from the inside. So I'm really pleased to have with us somebody that's also has been great inspiration for me. And so I want just to start with the first presentation of our moderators. Today I didn't want to be on stage constantly all the time because we have really long line of speakers. And I decide that I want just to introduce the two moderators of this night. And then when we will have our break, Ruth will go on by herself. And I will come back on stage just for the closing greetings. So just a moment that I have to turn my page. This is always the moment of... So I want to first of all introduce Marie Lechner, that will be the moderator of John Law, that is our keynote speaker for this time. And she's a French journalist, also she's writing about digital culture and art. She wrote a lot for Liberation and also Art Creative, among others, and she's also a researcher of media archaeology at the PAMAL, Preservation and Art Media Archaeology Lab at the École Supérieure d'Art in Avignon. My French is not so perfect, so sorry. At the same time, she has been also working on a lot of art exhibitions, organizing several conferences about web folklore, and I think it's a really interesting subject. And then after her, we will have as moderator Ruth Katlov, that, as I say, she's the co-founder and co-director with Mark Garrett of Furterfield. And they have been involved since the 90s, so is one of the groups that has been really working a lot on this subject in UK, in London, on the connection between art and technology. And at the same time also, they make possible to expand the network culture among a wide crowd of people that are not just experts, making it more accessible. They have been always working on this stuff and they still survive. So I think it's really great what they are doing and that they are here still doing that. And so now I just want to invite Marie to come to the stage and she will introduce John Law. And so thank you very much for being here and thank all of you for being today at the Disruption Lab.
Thank you, Tatiana. So, I'd like to tell you how I first heard about Cacophony Society, a legendary group of Californian misfits and leading figures of the 1980s underground scene, who were at the time quite unknown in France, even if they were the founding members of Burning Man, the huge ephemeral gathering in the Black Rock Desert in Nevada, which has taken place annually for the last 30 years. So at the end of May 2013, I received this curious email from a member of Urban Experiment, which is another very secretive group of Parisian urban explorers who were at the origin of several stunts in the city. One of their most extreme sections, called La Mexicaine de Perforation, the Perforating Mexicans, was responsible for setting up an underground cinema far below the Trocadero, which bar seats and electricity cable, all completely illegal. They hosted a clandestine film festival from 2000 until the authority discovered it, like 5 years later. The group also claimed to have conducted the 15 covert restoration all over Paris. Urban Six's more sensational exploit was completed in 2006 when they infiltrated the Pantheon and over the course of a year restored the 19th century clock, which had not chimed since the 1960s. So one of the members, who I didn't know, told me about the release of a book, Tales from the Cacophony Society, that you can find over here, and that one of its founding members, John Law, was in Paris. So I was very intrigued, and I went to the event in a small cafe in Paris, and I met John. And there I discovered like this crazy and anarchistic network of anti-conformists whose only common denominator was a passion for playing games. Emerging from the ashes of the mysterious suicide club, for nearly three decades, Cacophony Society's members climbed all the bridges in town, paddled through sewers, rappelled dance on facades, held midnight picnics in urban wastelands when they weren't busy organizing one of their numerous disruptive happenings. Initiators of gargantuan pranks and protests against anything and everything, Cacophonist creativity continues to irrigate the street theater developed by Improve Everywhere, the media hoaxes organized by the Yes Men, and the guerrilla communication practiced by the Adbusters activists who launch Occupy Wall Street. In my mind, closer to punks than hippies, to makers than hackers, they valued the homemade over commercial entertainment. As Jones says, it was a laboratory for experimenting with the culture and for experimenting with ourselves. They made adventure happen all around the corner and transformed San Francisco and soon other cities across the United States into a huge playground, contradicting the city without friction, the smart city, which strives to transform us into predictable creatures, anticipating our movements and behaviors, making sure that nothing ever happens to us. It may be salutary to recall the vital role of disorder, of chaos, of the unexpected in the urban experience. And it remains valid, especially in regards to the recent attack in Paris that killed 130 people and the nationwide state of emergency that we've been living under since, which gives exceptional power to the authorities, including the right to set curfew, limit people's movement, forbid mass gathering, establish secure zone where people can be monitored and close public spaces such as theaters, bar, and other meeting places. So Cacophony Society didn't do it for the money or for recognition, but for the lulz, to paraphrase Anonymous. It was a way for them to resist and revolt against modern society and its effort to domesticate and infantilize individuals. Among those who perpetuate their evil spirit, one could think of Anonymous. The cacophonist slogan reads like one of their communiqués. We are the pranksters, poets, artists, undisciplined children, wise fools and wise asses, the bug under the rug, the termites in society's scratches, the bad egg at the corporate picnic, the vital spirits of cultural fermentation. You may already be a member. And to tell this exhilarating adventure, so please welcome John Lowe, which has several other names, Sebastian Melmoth, Vito Lottoni, Ed Norton, member of the Suicide Club, and initiator of the Cacophony Society, co-founder of the Billboard Liberation Front, and joint organizer of the early Burning Man Festival.
The Cacophony Society.
Not at all true.
We're going to visit the sewers of Oakland. Now, some people might say that that's a redundant statement.
From a gourmet point of view, this is a choice sewer.
Just think how many poor oppressed souls that lived inside that television set.
And the guy turned on his bullhorn and he says, "Hey, stupid." And I knew he was talking to me.
Defenestration, defined as, quote, the act of throwing something or someone out of the window. Street teachers a piano.
two dozen pieces of furniture and household appliances being defenestrated from a four-story building.
These pieces of furniture that have taken it upon themselves to rid themselves of the slavery of their human captors.
And we'll be handing out body parts to various folks.
Are you going to eat this animal?
Perhaps later if we run out of other things.
What do we want?
Me!
When do we want it?
Me!
Do not kill the horrors of the meat eaters. Meat is genocide.
Santa's coming to town!
Santa's already here!
What do you think about Santa Claus?
Well, I didn't believe until now.
Biggest game on the North American continent, an Oldsmobile.
We'll be moving on to the next century, primordialism, primitivism coming back and all that, so be ready for it.
I hope you enjoyed that.
Bad people.
Hello. Hi. Thanks for having me here in Berlin. I'd like to thank the Kunstquartier Bethanien for hosting this event, and Tatiana, Bazzichelli, and Marie for coming from Paris for this, and the other presenters, thank you very much. Very excited to be here in Berlin. And I'm going to show you, I'm going to try to compress 40 years of history into 45 minutes. About 40 years of history and some more. So let's see if I can make this thing work. Voila. So I used Google Translator for my German. So if I hear you laughing, I'll know that you're laughing at Sergey Brin and not at me. So I did the best that I could with the German translations. Let's hope it works out. Now, of course, I say here that find out what you're supposed to do and then do something else, because, of course, everyone knows what you're supposed to do. Your parents tell you what you're supposed to do. Your government tells you what you're supposed to do. Your family sometimes tells you what you're supposed to do. So you know what that is, but then it's always better to do something else. Also, I'd like to think, for me, everything started in San Francisco. Now, I know that's not true for everyone, but I'd like to explain to you why and how the things that I was very lucky to be involved in San Francisco, some of them have had, fortunately, an effect, I think, in other areas in the world. And very, very, very fortunate to be part of that. So in San Francisco, as Oscar Wilde said, it's an odd thing, but anyone who disappears is said to be in San Francisco. San Francisco is an odd place where things always happen. Something's always happening there. It's a little askew. It's also a very beautiful city in the middle of a very beautiful area. And it's a place where people in the United States, see, the United States used to be a place that people from Europe and other places of the world went to when they wanted to get away from wherever they were before. And then as more people were in the United States, they kept pushing them further and further west until we ended up in California and in San Francisco. And you can go no further. If you were pushed out of San Francisco, you would drown. So people stayed in San Francisco. The strange people stayed in San Francisco and fought to be there. It was a place where many interesting things could happen, where people would go to recreate themselves. And in the 1970s, many people came to San Francisco because they couldn't live in the other parts of the country. It was difficult then. And they found a home in San Francisco. Strange groups that would come there and they would create their own religions because they didn't like the religions that they were brought up in. But when you were in San Francisco, you could just make your own religion. So this group, the Church of the Subgenius, you may not know of them, but they're well known in the United States for spreading their own dogma. It's called slack. And slack is something that you get if you don't work. You just sort of hang out. And that's what they would try to adhere to. Another church that started in San Francisco was the First Church of the Last Laugh. And they do a parade every year in San Francisco through the financial district. And this has been ongoing. This group is a holdover and a connecting piece. We say the missing link in anthropology between the hippies in the 60s and the punks, and then later the machine artists and the techno artists now. This parade is a connecting link between them. And Bishop Joey, who's a fellow with the drum, has been doing this event for 38 years now. And the big fellow down in the corner in the red suit is Wavy Gravy, who's an old hippie, one of the most famous hippies from the earlier period. So there's a continuity. I like to say there's a continuity of strangeness. When I started doing underground exploration and exploring this area of artistic endeavor, I was very young, and I thought that we invented it. I thought that we were the first people who ever did this stuff. And then as I got older, I read and I studied and I met people, and I find out that no, we were part of a long history of weirdos and strange people. And then, of course, there are the new ones coming along. So this parade's been ongoing for some time. Hundreds of people go through the financial district and wave at the bankers and tell them to quit working. Critical mass, which you may have heard of, was something that started in San Francisco. Some friends got together, Chris and some other friends of his got together and decided they would bike through traffic. And this event is ongoing now and is spread around the world. Chris Carlson and his crew, who are affiliated with the Cacophony Society and other groups. San Francisco is a very small town, very small town. So all the weirdos there tend to eventually meet all the other weirdos. So there's a lot of crossover between different types of groups. Litquake, which is a literary event, which started in San Francisco, is another group that has spread around the United States. And it started as a small event with friends who were writers who liked to drink. So they would go to bars and do readings, and then it has grown now into a major event with tens of thousands of people drinking and listening to readers, which is more effective earlier in the evening. I think later they're not listening so much. But it's a good party. The punk rock scene was a very big thing when I moved to San Francisco. Here's a Dead Kennedys, Jello Biafra. But in San Francisco, being a musician, you could be many other things. You could run for mayor, which Biafra did, run for mayor in San Francisco officially. And many other people ran that year too. Sister Boom Boom, who was in the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence. You saw a picture of the ladies earlier. She ran as well for mayor and making a political statement of sorts, but also using humor. Val Vale, who's the young fellow in this photograph with William Burroughs, was working at a bookstore in San Francisco, City Lights, and he wanted to start publishing about the new music scene in San Francisco in the late 70s. So he started a zine. You know what a zine is, a paper magazine. They used to have them back in the old days. And he started this publication called Search and Destroy, and then later it expanded into a publishing, small publishing business, and he published books that were very important to the culture in America. The Modern Primitives book was the tipping point for piercing and for tattooing for young people in the United States. Before this book came out and before this scene, the only people who got tattoos were sailors. And then after this, you can now blame Vail for your child having a tattoo on their forehead. Dead Kennedys, once again, Winston Smith, who was an artist who used what they call détournement. He would connect and use different images to make art. It's a style of connecting, influenced originally somewhat by the Situationists, and then later in the punk scene it was very big. In San Francisco, this was our contribution to this sort of thing. And then, as I said, there are many groups in San Francisco, and over time we all come to know one another. This is a group that I started when I was 18 with two other fellows, Simon Wagstaff and Irving Glick, and we would go and we would make corporate billboards say things that were more interesting than the corporations would say. And sometimes this was a very simple thing to do. This particular billboard, all you had to do was go turn the switches off on the letters, leaving the three letters lit that were important. Also, this billboard in 1996, a long time ago, was the first billboard, I think, to ever improve a neon electrical sign, which we did. This is, of course, a gift to the advertisers from us. We were helping them with their advertising. Here you see, for those of you old enough, you will remember Joe Camel. He was a cartoon character who smoked and sold cigarettes. So we put a nice skull over his head. This type of mixing media, which happened in Europe, of course, in New York and in San Francisco as well, there are different groups in different media that would use this type of this style of art. And this group, Negative Land, used sound. They were early sound collage and a big influence on sound mixing. And they would make some very incredible sound collages that would bend your thinking, and using commercial sounds and commercial music and commercial messages. They also coined, they made the term for the first time, culture jamming, if you've heard that. Negative Land in 1984 came up with that idea and gave it a word. Reality hacking is another English phrase, reality hacking. You know, you take the reel and cut it up. This culminated in larger expressions to the culture. One of them was Adbusters magazine, which is the most successful advertising campaign to sell non-advertising in the world. Very successful at that. And they also have good articles. There's another group, a very important group in San Francisco that I was lucky to work with at different times, a machine art group called Survival Research Labs. And I'm going to show a little video because it's very difficult to describe what this group does. Very difficult. But we'll show this video and maybe it'll make some sense. Oops, wrong one. Where does that start? Ah, there we go.
Thank you.
so this group, Survival Research Labs, which started in 1979, was the sort of the best of San Francisco collaborative art, because the reason that San Francisco was a good place to go to make things and to create your culture is because it was non-commercial. If you would go to, if you were an artist, let's say, you would go to New York, yes, or you'd go to maybe Los Angeles, and you would become, you would pursue your career as an artist. You'd work and become a good artist. Many artists, very fine, go to those places. They come to Berlin. In San Francisco, artists would go there, also crazy people, also pretty much anybody who was trying to get away from somebody else or something they didn't like. And there was not so much a commercial, there was no commercial intent for much of the work that was done when I came to San Francisco. So you could have a crazy idea, craziest idea you could have, and you go, I have this idea, and maybe 20 people would come and work with you to make the idea, to make it real, and then you would help them make their idea real. And some of these ideas were ridiculous. Some of them were wonderful. Some of them were everything in between. There was no critique. And this is one thing, it's difficult maybe in Europe to understand, but having no critique in San Francisco gave us a freedom to create things that maybe we would think too much about and not create if we were critiquing them. We critique them later. I'll get older, I'll critique more. But at the time that we were making them, it wasn't about critiquing. It was about working together with other people. So this group, Survival Research Labs, was a meritocracy where people would come, and if they liked to work on these crazy shows, there's nothing like working on a show like that. It's amazing. But you had to really love the work and want to work hard to do it. And the reward was being part of the work. And being a meritocracy, if someone came, the group was quite famous in the 90s, and people would come, the hipsters would come because it was cool. And my friend Mark Pauline, who runs this group, he would give them a shovel and have them do the dirtiest work in the grease pit. And if they could do that, they could stay. But it wasn't to be cool to be there. It was to be part of this art and work. So there are other people who came to the Bay Area who are different in some ways. But there was a lot of connection between the internet world and between the early groups in the 70s and 80s and later 90s, including the groups that I was involved in, the Suicide Club, Survival Research Laboratories, and the later Cacophony Society. Daniel Kotke, who's a fellow on the left there, he, one of the early Apple designers, was in the Cacophony Society and a big supporter of that group. So this crossover, you know, was a good thing, I think, in some respects. John Gilmore, who started the Electronic Frontier Foundation, which is a group that's been wrestling with the government on encryption and other important issues. He was a friend of mine in the Suicide Club. John Perry Barlow, who's there too, came on some Golden Gate Bridge climbs to the top of the bridge with us in the Suicide Club. And then they, of course, do their work. Brewster Kahle, who started the Internet Archive, who a wonderful, wonderful organization. He is archiving everything on the internet. And he has several server farms around the world, and they try to collect everything on the internet. He was a big supporter of Cacophony, and also he and his wife, Mary, were the first people married at the Burning Man Festival in 1992. The first internet chat room, which was a chat room about sex, of course, was, and many other things, was a Bianca's Smut Shack, and there was some crossover between these groups. So what I'm trying to explain is in San Francisco, there's very fertile ground for people to interconnect with other people. Now I'll talk about the groups that I was lucky to be involved in. As I was telling a friend earlier, I came to San Francisco in 1976. And if you know about San Francisco, you know that it was very well known for the hippies in the 1960s. So I came there, and I'm 17 years old, very excited, and I'm like, hey, here I am in San Francisco. Where's the party? Where's the party? Let's go. And all of the hippies were very tired, very tired. And they said, you should go home. Go back to Tennessee. The party was it was 10 years ago. It's over. This party's over. So I thought, wow, that's too bad. And then within a year, I was in this group, the Suicide Club. Within a year, the punk scene started. And ever since then, I'm very careful. I don't listen to hippies so much, although I like some of them. So our group started with a group called Communiversity. And once again, Communiversity, and I can't make this thing stop, Communiversity was a group that came out of the free university movement in the 1960s. Once again, hats off to that movement. And we were a free school, and people could give classes. I was involved in this when I was 19, 20 years old, and anyone could give a class. You know, a teacher could give a class, a student could give a class. Anyone could do it, and anyone could take the class, and everything was free. And you see, free in the United States is a very, very strange thing. Having something for free, people don't understand it. They don't understand it. It's like, what is it? How do you make money with that? So we didn't. So we were very stupid that way. But our school was free, and out of it, the classes would become more unusual over time. It started as an adjunct, as a part of an official university, San Francisco State University, in 1970. And it was an official thing, and then the students ran it, but it was free. And then, because the students ran it for a while, after about 5 years, they were doing such crazy classes that the university says, no, you can't do that. So the students who ran the school said, well, fuck you, and they took the school and made it a nonprofit organization and took it away from the school. So they ran it themselves. And then we would raise money by having a garage sale. And a garage sale is where everybody gives your stuff. Everybody donated their stuff, their phone, their stereo, and we would sell it in a sale to raise money. And you could pay whatever you wanted. We didn't have a price on anything. There was no price. So you gave what you thought was fair. So every once in a while, somebody would have like an iMac computer, you know, and somebody would give you €5 for it, right? What an asshole. But you didn't say that. You said, fine, take the computer. For every one person who did that, there were 40 people who would give you €5 for something that was not very valuable. So it balanced out. For every asshole, there were 40 cool people, pretty much, when it came to this type of fundraising for us. So out of this free school, a group came called the Suicide Club, because Gary Warren, who was the fellow who ran the Communiversity with Shirley Sheffield and some other people, he kept doing more and more strange and unusual events as a class in Communiversity. And he finally realized that he should make a secret club so that the people who really liked doing the extreme events could then just join that club and they didn't have to go to school for it. So he made a club that was based on the writings, partially, on the writings of Robert Louis Stevenson, and he wrote a book called The Suicide Club. And that was about a group of characters who get together and live each day as though it were their last, because any one of them could die at any point in time because they had a lottery and someone was designated as the assassin and one person was designated as the prey, and then they would be killed. So they didn't know when they were going to die. They could die at any time. So wasting time would be a mistake for them. So here's my friend Gary Warren, who started this group in 1977. He had a bookstore. Here's the other fellow who started the group, David T. Warren, who, I don't know how to keep this thing from going. This is an odd thing here. At any rate, David was an older fellow at the time, and he had worked for the circus carnivals, and he would do things all on his own because he was an odd character, like a crazy man. He would go to the public places and dare people to break mirrors and to walk under ladders because it's bad luck to do that, and he thought that people shouldn't believe in bad luck. He would go, do you know the Salvation Army? Do you know Salvation Army? They have the big cauldron with money, and they have a bell. They ring the bell, you know, and then people donate money to Salvation Army, yeah? So David would go dressed up as a Salvation Army with a cauldron full of money and a sign that said, free money, take some. And he would ring his bell at Christmas time. So he ran out of money after a while. Here he is, giving away money. Crazy. In America, this is crazy. They'll put you in a hospital for that. Just giving away money. So the Suicide Club began, and we had a newsletter. It came in the mail. The mail is paper, and it goes into an envelope. And a guy in a blue suit comes, and he takes it and puts it on a truck. Anyway, that's how we used to communicate. Very primitive, but that's how we used to communicate. And here are some sample newsletters, you see. Because everyone was the editor. Every month there was a newsletter. And each newsletter would be edited by a different person. So sometimes you'd have an interesting art, maybe a good graphics. Other times, very boring, you know. But everyone had a chance to do it. No one was the boss. No one ran the group. Even the people who started it, they're like, we don't run it. We all run it. So it was collaborative that way. We did many events. Because the hippies, you know, were long gone. We're not long gone, but the hippies were kind of finished. We did a event where we, celebrated the 10-year anniversary of the Summer of Love. We would also do events like food fights. We had a friend, Pierre, and Pierre was in a house that he rented, yes? And his landlord was very bad, didn't like him, and he was being thrown out. So he thought, because the Suicide Club encouraged people to create events for any reason at all, could be anything. So Pierre thought, well, I'm a chef, my father's a chef, we'll take bad food and have a food fight in my apartment. So he invited the Suicide Club to his apartment, which he was being thrown out of, and he had a giant food fight in it. And then when they were finished with the food fight, he left, and then he gave the apartment back to his landlord. So, and this is what they looked like after they hosed themselves down outside. And here's Gary Warren right here, David T. Warren, and Adrian Burke, who are the three people of four who started the Suicide Club. And they're the reason that I am now an unindicted criminal. So I thank them every day for my life. One time we did one event that was a legal event in a theater. And I don't know, how is the German translation from Google? Is it good or no? So? German translation, Uwe? What do you say? Terrible, huh? Okay. Well, it's Sergey Brin's problem, not mine. So talk to Google about that. We would do different events and pranks. This was an early Suicide Club event at the beach. We would do costume games, like this one, which is called Decoy Street. Took place in a very tough neighborhood in San Francisco on the street. We would do other costume games based on fiction. This was a recreation of a mystery fiction that we live act play on the street. And the man who, his event in the Suicide Club, he created this because he liked detective fiction. And he thought, well, if I could make an event about detective fiction, that would be good. He liked detective fiction so much that he began giving a street tour later, after his Suicide Club event, about the American author Dashiell Hammett. And Dashiell Hammett was the author who created the concept of hard-boiled detective fiction. He created a character called Sam Spade, who was a hard-boiled detective in the novel The Maltese Falcon. So Don started doing a walking tour in 1977 based on his events in the Suicide Club. And it is now, 38 years later, the longest-lived literary walking tour in America. He's been doing it for 38 years. He's been written about in every journal. He's been written about in the London Times, in the New York Times, and been all over the place. Because his love for this particular field of interest was, he learned that he could create something out of it by doing events together in a collaboration with other people. And it gave him confidence to do something very interesting. Another fellow, we used to go in the Suicide Club, we would sneak into abandoned buildings a lot. There were many abandoned buildings in San Francisco at that time, and we would do events in them. And so another fellow, Bill Castura, liked the abandoned buildings so much that he started studying them, and later ended up becoming an architectural historian because of sneaking into abandoned buildings. So the Suicide Club was a great field for this sort of thing. We would do other events, take people blindfolded on the city bus to some place they do not wear. We would explore abandoned buildings. We would take over and do street theater in elevators. This is an elevator inside a parking garage in Union Square, the big shopping district in San Francisco. And we took over three elevators, and every time the elevator opened, people wouldn't get in. And some of this stuff would make interest in the press. Charles Colson, you all may have heard of Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon, yes, no? He was a president. We didn't like him. He had an assistant whose name was Charles Colson. And Charles Colson was a very bad fellow, and he was giving a talk in a hotel in San Francisco, so we hit him in the face with a pie. So anyway, it was like we were going to assassinate him. I felt in my stomach that I was going to die. It was very scary, assassinating this fellow. And then billboards. The Billboard Liberation Front started in the Suicide Club. This was the first billboard that we did in 1977. There were two of them back to back. This is the other one. And then also the Suicide Club was great for encouraging people to do events, as I said. Now, not everybody can climb billboards, not everybody can, climb bridges, but my friend Carla Wood had been a burlesque dancer, and she wanted to do a burlesque show for her friends and for people that she liked, not for stinky old men. So there was an abandoned theater, abandoned, like this place here, but abandoned, completely collapsed, that she had worked in when she was younger, and she wanted to do a show in there. So the Suicide Club took over the building and made a burlesque show inside this abandoned building illegally and brought in the audience from the side door in the dark of 100 people. And then she created an event. Even though she said, I don't know how to climb a bridge, I don't know how to go in the sewers, but I'd like to do an event. So you could do an event. The idea with this group is you would make a real world happening out of your fantasy in your head. And it was very important for that. This is a business meeting. And then, of course, we became a little bit well known for climbing bridges. This is a photo I took on the underside of the Golden Gate Bridge many years ago. We're climbing the Bay Bridge here. This right there, that's one of the founders of the Cacophony Society, Gene Mashofsky, and there they are on the cables. So bridge climbing was a thing that we did, urban infrastructure. Here's a later photo taken in Detroit, climbing the Ambassador Bridge. And here's climbing the Golden Gate Bridge again, many, many years ago. We also did street theater. This was the one thing I've talked about before, which is climbing things was not frightening to me. There's no fear. But getting naked in public was very frightening to me. So doing this event was a big thing for me as a young man, because I was middle class, and that's, you just don't get naked in public, bad thing. We did other events. I'll start maybe a little bit faster here. We had an ongoing bridge dinner on the Golden Gate Bridge, where we would meet with, you know, a couple hundred people and have dinner, cook dinner. Naked cable car, you know. Here we are once again on the naked cable car in the street. This was the 1970s, so there was a lot of sex. It's all true, what you heard. Another event inside Gary Warren's old bookstore. So this stuff led into the Suicide Club ending in 1977. I'm sorry, in 1983 it finished. And then for some years, we didn't have a collective group. And then we started a group called the Cacophony Society a little bit later. It was inspired by Emperor Norton. So there are many things that inspired the events that we were doing and inspired Gary Warren and the Suicide Club. Among them were the Surrealists and the Dadaists, who were very influential in his thoughts. And, of course, we did events sometimes based on famous art. This is a panel from the book that I co-wrote about the Cacophony Society, kind of an homage to the Surrealists. There were other things that were influential. There was a network of small business owners in the Bay Area that traded. They bartered their services with one another rather than paying money. And some of these people were influential in the Suicide Club. Stuart Brand and the Whole Earth catalog inspired a thing called the New Games Foundation, which was a group that went around the world and collected interesting games and taught them at schools, and they were connected with stuff that we were doing. We were inspired by the Diggers, which were a wonderful hippie group. They were interested in the concept of giving free food to people, and also of living your life as though you were the lead actor in your own movie. They had this philosophy that if you lived as though you were a character in a movie, then your life would be exciting and adventurous. Of course, some of the hippies were cool. We liked some of the hippies, okay? Ken Kesey, I liked. He was the guy who, at the big events in the 1960s, he would open the back door and let people in for free. So he was cool. The Cockettes, which were a group, a wonderful group in San Francisco of theater performers. Many of them were gay. And this was in the very early 70s, famous group. And they had a big influence, I think, on the theatricality of the Suicide Club and the later Cacophony Society. And Ant Farm, which is an art group in San Francisco. Earlier, these are the earlier groups, the ones that inspired us. They did these wonderful art events. They found a crazy Texas millionaire, made a lot of money with oil, and he paid for these Cadillacs to be buried. And here they are some years later. They did a wonderful event called Media Burn, which, you know, there's some symbolism in there somewhere, but I'm not a critic, so I couldn't say what. The other things that influenced the Suicide Club and Cacophony Society were fiction, pulp fiction and interesting, strange fiction, adventure fiction, movies that inspired. We would show movies. Gary Warren had a 16-millimeter movie projector, and we would show a movie in his bookstore, and then we would go do an event, go out in the world and do an event based on the movie. Don Heron, of course, did his Dashiell Hammett events based on the writings of Hammett. We would show, this is from the movie The Third Man, set in Vienna, and we showed this movie on a projector, and then we went and explored the sewers in Oakland after being in the movie. So it's like you went from the movie into the movie. It was a very strange mindset. We showed this movie, and then we went and slept in a cemetery all night long. So this is the book that we wrote about the later group, the Cacophony Society, which I have about 10 minutes to talk about. And this is the group that started in 1986. It's the group that the event you may have heard of, Burning Man, came out of. It's the group that inspired a novel called Fight Club. I was very lucky to be involved in this group. We did our own newsletters. We still had mailmen back then. There was no internet, common internet yet. And we would do our newsletters. And many people, once again, the editorship of the newsletters rotated, and the Sisters of Perpetual Indulgence were involved in Cacophony. You know, here's Sister Kitty and Sister Dana, and they edited the Cacophony newsletter many times. And there's Sister Dana. She's a journalist, by the way, a pretty good one. Then, of course, there's a Santa thing. We can't get rid of the Santa thing, however much we try. So in 1994, Santa Rob, who likes to remain anonymous, we call him Rob, he had an idea that we would dress up like Santa Claus and go down to the big hotels and to the to Macy's department store and celebrate Christmas in our own way. So we did. Now, of course, I ended up believing that, see, I learned in the Suicide Club that when you go on the street and you do street theater of any type, you're playing, but everybody else is in the game, not just you. Everybody's in the game. The police are in the game. You know, the business owners are in the game. Other people on the street are in the game. And if you do something that you think is funny, maybe they don't think it's so funny, and they'll walk up and punch you in the nose, maybe, or they'll try to arrest you. You can't be mad about that because they're in the game too. It's all fair. You have to be a smart player of the game. And as long as the game goes well for you, you're a hero. As soon as you do something stupid, you're an idiot. And that's how doing street theater works, or at least for me. Here we are in New York on the SantaCon in 1998, and we're at the United Nations building, and we're protesting the United Nations. And we had our little things that said, or UN out of the North Pole and things like that. Anyway, it took 3 minutes for the United Nations security police to surround us. Their security was very good. So we went to another place after that. We got on the subway, of course, because we're in New York. And then we ended up at the Brooklyn Bridge, which some of us climbed. I climbed that with Santa Dennis from Detroit. Now, when you're in New York City, if you're there for a while, you will eventually see a celebrity. You know, maybe Robert De Niro, maybe Harvey Keitel. But no, we accidentally ran into Michael Moore, who we mobbed and pranked a little bit. My friend Ron English, who, if you saw the video of the billboard that we did with Ronald McDonald, he was my partner in that. Here's the bad Santa, very bad Santa. Good Santas, here are the good Santas. And then later, this was where I met this fellow, who's Chuck Palahniuk, who wrote the book Fight Club. And he was a Santa in Portland. And see, we were going to not do the SantaCon again because we were tired of it after doing it two years. But Portland Cacophony, because by this time, the Cacophony group had split, and there were five or six of them in different cities around the country. And so Portland Cacophony decided to do SantaCon. And we thought, well, that will be fun. We'll go to Portland. It's a nice, quiet town. What could possibly go wrong in Portland? So we go there. And what happened was the police in Portland knew we were coming because the San Francisco police told them. So for 3 days, we were followed around by police everywhere we went. And we had hundreds of Santas. So Santa Chuck Palahniuk I met, and I didn't know him, and he wasn't famous. He had written a book that no one had bought, and he was writing an article, and he was taking notes, and he kept asking me all these questions. And I thought, who is? I asked him, I said, are you a cop? Are you a cop? And he goes, no. He started laughing, and he goes, no. Turns out he was a writer, and he had been in the Portland Cacophony Society for 3 years and ended up writing his book, Fight Club, about his experiences partially about his experiences in Cacophony. So anyway, so this was from our book. This is our panel about the Chuck Palahniuk and his project Mayhem, which was the group that he created for the book Fight Club. And then there's I just like this. This is a little tiny thing I stole online from the movie Fight Club. This is at the end of the movie, based on his novel, where they blow up the credit card skyscrapers. Those are Visa and MasterCard. Something about it just warms my heart. I really like that. So we did other events. Some of them were quite offensive. We did a thing called the Meat Parade in the middle of a big public parade in Berkeley. A lot of vegetarians in Berkeley. Vegetarians, but some of my best friends are vegetarians. But we wanted to make fun of eating meat. So we did. The woman in red, I lived with her for 9 years. I did whatever she said, anytime she said. And this is our group, PETA, People Eating Them Animals. And we're this is our protesters, because this is in Berkeley, California. And Berkeley, California is a very liberal place. So anytime you're in Berkeley, if there's a protest, there will be a counter-protest. So this is our counter-protest. They were against the meat people. So at any rate, another prank. Because this event is about pranks and stunts. So these are some of the stunts that Cacophony Society did. We decided we would protest the movie Fantasia, which is a Disney movie for children and for adults. But who would protest such a movie? I mean, only crazy people would protest such a movie. But we protested it, and in front of the theater where it was playing, and this protest got in the media. It was taken seriously, and Time Magazine did a cover article about whiny California identity politics. And they used this event as the premier example of why California politics are so stupid. Fact-checking. We have some journalists here. You guys fact-check this stuff, right? So here we are. This is my old partner, Michael, who's one of the co-founders of the Burning Man Festival. This is when he had Jesus. We did other events. This is one. In San Francisco, there's a giant race every year with 200,000 people called Bay to Breakers. It goes from the San Francisco Bay to the ocean, 200,000 people. So the Cacophony Society, for many years, would dress up as salmon and go the wrong way. So, wrong way, that's the way we always go. Another event done by wonderful creative man, Peter Doty. You've heard of Food Not Bombs? You know Food Not Bombs? Anybody? Food Not Bombs? It's a group that, a very wonderful group that gives food to poor people for free. And they fight the government because the government doesn't want them giving away food because of health code violations. Anyway, they do an event every week where they give away food to homeless people. So we did an event where we dressed up like French aristocrats and we delivered beautiful cakes for dessert to the people afterwards. And then we would deliver the crumbs of the cakes on a silver tray to the mayor of San Francisco. So I'm going to keep going really fast here. Bombs Not Food, Rabbits, Race of Doom. We were the thousandth jumper off the Golden Gate Bridge. Project Maine, we already saw that one. You've already seen this stuff, the Ronald McDonald billboards. You've seen all that. We went to, of course, the police came. It's not a party. It's not a good party until the police come. Then you know it's a good party. Here we are. The police come. They didn't arrest any of us, but they arrested the ringleader. They arrested the ringleader and took him away. Bad Ronald. Urban Iditarod, which is a drinking event based on the Alaskan Iditarod. Here we have people in the Iditarod. More rough drafts. Zone trips, this is a long story about the underpinnings of the Burning Man event. the zone trip. Burning Man was a zone trip, and that was a cacophony type of event based on the writings of and the movies of Andrei Tarkovsky and the writings of the Strugatsky brothers, some Russian novelists. And the zone was a place where anyone could go and anything could happen whatsoever. And so we took the first zone trips were to Los Angeles, where we would, it was like surreal tourism, and we would go to these different places and view them as though we were in another world. I had always wanted to go to the Hollywood Letters, so we went to the Hollywood Letters and climbed them. And then really quickly, the Burning Man event, which you probably heard of, is the thing that started as a cacophony event. And it came out of this collective. See, San Francisco was such a fertile place and all these different interconnecting people. I didn't create this event, and the other people who run the event now didn't create it. It came from a collective, collaborative confederation of people doing things. Here's the newsletter, that the first rough draft newsletter in 1990. Here we are. This is the first year going to the desert in 1990. David T. Warren, one of the founders of the Suicide Club in the red suit, lit the man by blowing a 12-foot flame onto him. And Steve Mobia, wonderful guy. In 1990, there were two drummers at Burning Man, and they were both good drummers. They weren't bad white guys playing bongos. They were actually really good drummers. Burning Man. Desert Site Works, which was an event that the Burning Man philosophy was based on. You can ask me more about that later if you want. We did these large-scale art, living art events where we created an environment and lived in it as artists and performed together to make a world, to make our life. And this is Hot Springs in the Black Rock Desert for the Desert Site Works event, which influenced the Burning Man event later. Machine Art, Seaman was a great machine art group that was the first machine art group to perform at Burning Man. Art cars, more art cars. You've seen all of this. The car hunt. We remote controlled an automobile so it drove by itself, and we hunted it down with real guns and real ammunition. And it kept going there, shooting at it until it was filled with 5,000 holes. Kill Your TV, you saw that on the video. We smashed up a bunch of television sets. Great book about San Francisco underground, sewers. You know, I'll just keep going, and I'm going to finish up in just a minute. These are some of the types of things that different people came up with ideas for, and they would make an event out of, and people would come and help them create the event. There's no money involved in this. The only time money was charged was if you had a cost, out-of-pocket cost, and people would help contribute to pay for your cost. There was no profit. Financial needs, with the exception of Burning Man, which is now a very successful corporation that makes a lot of money that I don't have anything to do with. But probably should have stayed in a little bit longer, huh? New York Underground. Anyway, I'm going to cut it off here because we're going to do a Q&A. I was going to talk about some of the stuff that's going on now because there are a lot of groups now that in San Francisco and in New York that still do this kind of thing. Cacophony is no longer really a good organization, but there are ones that have come since then. And maybe Marie and I can discuss that. So anyway, that's it for my presentation. Thank you very much. And then Marie Lechner is going to sit up here and ask me some questions, and I'll ask her some questions. So.
The concept of dérive, you know, the situationist termed it, of psychogeographical perambulation is kind of crucial to the Suicide Club, but also in Cacophony Society method of approaching the city. But even if you prefer to relate yourself to pataphysics or Dada. And I was wondering if this dérive is still possible in today's city, where you're always tracked by your smartphone, your security camera, in the context of this kind of massive surveillance that has been developed in the cities. Do you think the city has changed since you?
So the question is, do I think that pranking in the city and street theater in the city in a psychogeographical sense is still possible in the growing security state? Yeah, I think it's still possible. You just have to be a little bit more smart about how you go about it. You have to learn more about cameras and know where they are, or try to find out where they are and work with them. Sometimes, and depending on how many people you have and the groups, I'm not the only person who did the Santa thing, but my idea for the Santa thing was that, and this is many years ago, I haven't done it for many years, but was that everyone would dress exactly the same. So it was impossible to tell one Santa from the next. Impossible. So if you have 1,000 Santas and you can't tell them apart, it's very difficult to arrest one of them, because it's very difficult to be sure that you have the right bad Santa. So there are different techniques that you can use, and I expect that the young people out here will figure that out, because, you know, I don't think as quickly as I used to, but they've got ideas about stuff like that, how to hack the security state.
And you were saying, which was quite a good news, that there are still groups like this in San Francisco today. Maybe you can.
Sure. Yeah, I ran out of time with my slide presentation, but I did want to comment and say I have many slides about groups that are ongoing and doing a lot of infrastructure exploration, and they're finding ways to get into places. And these people have no bad intent; they're not, they're not terrorists or anything like that. But they want to go in and explore and understand infrastructure sites, and there are a lot of people doing that right now. It's a huge world of that outside, and they trade information about that sort of thing. There are people doing street theater and underground events. Most of the people who do that in San Francisco had to move out of San Francisco because it's too expensive there now, but they moved across the bay to Oakland, which is a better town, kind of like moving to East Berlin used to be, where it was cheaper and interesting people would go. So yeah, I'd say this stuff is still happening.
And also, you talked about Gary Warren, and you remembered you remind the motto he made, like, live each day as though it was your last. But also, he wrote that fear is a freeze on the future. The filter or floodgate that stops our imaginings, and he also in the chaotic principles. There is a lot of a statement about fear and about how you should confront these fears. And I was wondering why it was so pregnant in important in.
Well, the idea of challenging your personal fears was a big thing for Gary Warren, who was the main creator of the Suicide Club. There were other people who were quite important, but he was the first with the idea, and then it became a confederation. I don't call it a collective. It wasn't really a collective. It was a confederation, which means individuals who choose to work together for a specific purpose, but not for their whole life. They agree with each event, whether they're going to do it or not. He was very much about agreement, you would agree, and very much about truth-telling. He didn't lie. And so for him, the fear came from, he realized that at a young age, he was filled with fear, and that he was a very smart guy, and he realized at some point that a lot of his fears were based on stuff that he didn't know about. His fears were based on ephemera, on phantoms. And so he would challenge him. He would create an event. If he was very afraid of something, he would create an event so he'd have other people come and help him do it. And then it wasn't as scary. I make the example for me of getting naked in public, which is not that big of a deal really, but it was very frightening to me as a 19-year-old boy. You can't do that. But I did it with a group of people, and we were all laughing and having fun. And it was on the cable car, which is a tourist attraction in San Francisco. And we went through Chinatown, and the little old Chinese ladies going to work in the morning, they just looked at us like, wow, what a bunch of idiots. And I realized it doesn't really matter. They're not going to kill us. What's the worst thing that could happen to me for being naked in public? I might get arrested and then they let me out. Probably not, though. What's the worst thing that could really happen? So this was the concept of challenging the fears. Like, if you don't know what's going to happen, do a controlled experiment challenging your fear, and then you'll see how
bad
it is.
It seems that today lots of of the politics and society is like conducted by this freezing state of
fear.
Fear, yeah.
Yeah, Orwell, read Orwell and Huxley. He'll tell you all about that.
And many of your events were illegal also.
What's that?
Many of your events were illegal, like when you climbed on the Golden
yes.
Bridge. But what was your attitude when you get caught or when...
Many of our events were illegal, but none of them were immoral. And there's a big difference between illegal and immoral. I have a young son, and I teach him the difference between illegal and immoral. I go, well, you know, illegal, you have to think about. You know, is it? Sometimes there's a good reason for a law. Sometimes it's a very stupid reason. You have to decide if you're going to obey that law or not. If you disobey a law that's stupid law, if they catch you, they're still going to punish you. So you have to decide: is it worth the risk? But immoral is something you don't do. If you know something is not right and bad, you don't do it. An example would be the Billboard Liberation Front. We chose not to damage the existing billboards, okay? There were many reasons for this. One of them is because we felt, well, it's America and it's private property, so we don't want to damage the billboards. We'll just borrow them. We would put our covers on the existing billboard, but they came right off. We made them so they came right off. And we would leave a bottle of good whiskey for the sign workers who came. So they would come, and we'd leave a note for them that said, "Hi, sign workers, we hope you're having a good day. Have a drink on us." And so, see, they're not our enemy. We like the sign workers. You know, they're working hard for Coca-Cola or whoever. And everybody has to work for a corporation. Almost everyone has to work for a corporation. It's like being a prostitute when you have to because it's the only job you can get. It's just you try to get a better street corner.
So. And also when you say anyone could propose an event, but the only requirement in those events was leave no traces and no spectators, which is
no
spectators,
yeah, that was
which is
two.
Very
yeah.
important in
very important,
the Burning
yeah.
Man event.
Yes, in the Suicide Club, you couldn't be an observer. And there, because of that, there are some photographs you've seen, there's some film, but not that much because we believe that If you were photographing or video, you know, filming an event, you weren't a full participant. So being a full participant was quite important. We weren't doing these events for the outside world, for an audience. Some of the street theater, yes, outside world saw it, but they weren't so important. What was important was how it affected us and how we did it. Because when we started street theater, we were terrible at it. We weren't actors. We were just ridiculous. We were awful. After a couple of years, we got better at it, you know, like, and then it wasn't as much fun. But so yeah, the fear
for the leave no traces also no trace, like
yeah.
the kind of you came to a place and then you just
yeah.
vanished in
exactly.
a way without
leave no trace was very important. And leave no trace was you would use a space like an abandoned building or you'd go on a bridge and you would leave it exactly as you found it. And we were fanatic about this. We did a huge event in an abandoned mortuary, a giant building for the dead, abandoned. And a huge event we brought in coffins and food. And it was an abandoned building, right? An abandoned building. We took all of our garbage out. We didn't even leave our garbage inside the abandoned building. We cleaned everything out of it as though we had never been there. We were quite fanatic about it. And this leave no trace philosophy then, we brought it to Burning Man, where it was true for a couple of years, and now it's a sales pitch, but it was quite true for some time.
So if I ask you how you analyze the evolution of the Black Rock Festival?
Could I analyze this, the evolution of the Burning Man Festival? Yeah, if you have a week.
What happened?
You have a week, you know, maybe we could start right now. We'll be done in January. It's the Burning Man Festival is a lot of things. It's very different than when I was involved. I left a long time ago. I did 7 years of creating that event, and 6 years were marvelous, and 1 year was horrible. A lot of accidents and people hurt. And the event was an anarchist-based free event when we started it, and because of the nature of the event and because of the fact that it became the vacation of choice for the internet kids, okay? It's a wonderful, it's many things. It's a good event in many ways, okay? I don't want to just say it's a stupid event. It's not, but it is also a very effective safety valve for Silicon Valley, okay? Because all of those kids, they work all year round. They work 90 hours a week. They work 14 hours a day. They make good money, but they literally are owned by their companies, Google and Facebook. They're part of the corporate identity. They work for them constantly. So it's required for them to have an incredible vacation that blows their mind. So Burning Man is the perfect corporate vacation for internet kids. Perfect corporate vacation. Because what they do is instead of going to Bali and drinking a little bit and smoking some weed, they go to Burning Man, they do acid, and they have sex with somebody they just met. And they do this for like a week long, and it's mind-blowing, and it's a wonderful thing. And then when they're done with that, that is enough juice, that is enough power for them to go back to their stupid job and work in a cubicle for the next year. That's Burning Man. It's many other things, too. Good things. Good things, too, but that's a big part of it.
So when many people talk about Burning Man as a movement, I remember that you once told me that hedonism is not the best goal to anchor a political movement. Hedonism. Hedonism.
Oh, yeah. Hedonism. Hedonism is not the best. It's not the best anchor for an important movement. You know, the civil rights movement was an important movement. The Maker Movement, which started in California, is an important movement, if you know what that is. The Maker Movement, which encourages... In America, we got away from learning how to make things with our hands and how to do technical work. And so the Maker Movement, which is influenced by Burning Man a little bit originally, is an important movement because it encourages children and young people to once again build things and experiment in the real world, not just on their computer, not just... in their heads, and not just, but to make things and to work together to make things. So that's an important movement, I think. And I'm very, very, very proud of the tiny, tiny bit of influence I might have had on that event, on that movement. Burning Man is a party. It's a party movement.
Yeah, but you'd say also SantaCon is also kind of a party, but you once told me that during the Occupy the movement, the organizer called the Burning Man's offices to inquire about how to install their own temporary zone. So
I don't think I told you that, but somebody else might have. But yeah,
it was you.
Okay, no, I don't think so, but I know what you're talking about.
Okay.
And yeah, Summer Burks, who's a writer in California, she believes, and she's involved in Occupy, she believes that the Occupy movement was influenced by the Cacophony principles and by some of the Burning Man organizing. And that may be true, but I couldn't verify that, but it sounds right. I mean, like I say, it's a lot of connections between people, so.
And also, but this I'm sure it was you. when we talked together last time in Paris, you told me that even if the artists were very involved in the event, imbued with a political tone, Cacophony was not a political or artistic movement. It was a social experiment.
Important point. The Suicide Club, when it started... Oh, okay. What? Oh, yeah, okay. So, yeah. I'll just finish this one question real quick. The Suicide Club was... What was the question again? It was not a political movement or anything like that. Although many of the events that we did had political interpretations, we didn't intend to or we didn't push that part of it. We saw it more as a social experiment of us working together to change our lives. If it had an effect somewhere else, that's great. In the case of SantaCon, maybe not so great. But anyway, do we have any questions from the audience?
You want to check the
wireless?
Yeah.
Oh, they have. Oh, they got.
Oh, they
okay.
Have one.
Here we go.
Excuse me.
Hello. I do not want to mention this as a critique, but I would like to ask. Don't you think like that this sort of movements, in a way, were born and raised out of like a very privileged context? I mean, for example, Berlin 89, people could live out of thin air. But I mean, I'm from Lisbon, and people they need to have two jobs and everything. And I'm actually very active in a lot of these disruptive collectives. But it's very difficult to keep up because there's really no money for these people to just survive.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a very good point. Yeah. Some people don't have the luxury to play, and that's terrible, and that's a sad thing. And the fact that some people don't have the luxury to play is something I'm very sad about, but having that ability and the ability to do that and to encourage other people to do that, I think is a good thing. I'm not a saint. I'm not working with Mother Teresa, but I think that what we've done is positive, and I'd like to consider it as positive. But yeah, of course, there are always people who are going to be poor and incapable of doing things that you or I are capable of doing. So I don't know what to say about that. Should we die?
Hi. Also, too, I guess similarly, I was also curious because you've mentioned a lot of really amazing events that you guys kind of pulled off, and I'm wondering where the role of money comes into it, because you talked a lot about, like, everything was free, everything's free, and I don't actually know what it is that you've made, been able to make money on throughout your lifetime, but I'm just curious, like, is there a place for... Well, do you think there's a place, though, for money to be involved in these things? It's not exploitative, but just, you know, like, I don't know. I mean, you do need money to make things go forward, so...
Yes, you need money to live. That's correct. And we're well aware of that. I've had a day job my entire life. And when I was younger, it was easy because I didn't have to sleep. So I have to be more smart about it now. But I have a day job, and I have a small business, and I spend as little time as I can with that to do the other stuff that I do that I consider to be my real work. And I'm lucky in some ways that I'm able to do that. I don't make that much money, but it's enough. And for other people, some of the events, you know, no, I don't think doing something creative and making money from it is evil. I think it depends on how you go about it, and it depends on what your goals are. But creating a collective, collaborative group, you get a lot of power from just having a lot of people involved. You get a lot of resources that one person wouldn't have if you have a group of people that are contributing resources. And so that was a big way that I think, and also in the 1970s and 80s in San Francisco, it was much cheaper to live there. And so we were able to do some things then that are harder now. They're harder to do now because of the money situation. So yeah, it's a problem. So I suggest to people, have a good day job that doesn't take much time. Try to find something you can do that you make good money at and separate that from your creative life. Or if you can work in a creative job that feeds you to the extent that it's enough for you, then that's great. If you're a filmmaker and you're making a living at it, let's say. If you're a writer and you're making a living at it, one of the three writers in the world that are still making a living at it, you know, if you can do that, that's great. But it's not that easy to make money doing this stuff. Who's going to pay for this? They'd be nuts.
Yeah, so I think you've been talking a lot about play, and for me, the word play kind of connotes elements of this hedonistic, like, liberation type of thing, but also entertainment. And I was wondering if you thought there was some kind of difference then between what is entertaining and what is playfully disruptive or genuinely disruptive, and how can we, for example, I think in the Berlin scene, people are really good at making these types of festivals a really kind of hedonistic feel where people can let everything out even the whole weekend through, you know, every single weekend the whole year. And how can you push that kind of creation or that amount of creation towards something that might be genuinely disruptive? I don't know if you have any thoughts on that.
Well, you can use what you're doing, the art or the pranks that you're doing, to point a light at things that people need to know about that maybe they don't. You can use humor to make fun of corporations, and if you do it in such a way that that people who don't agree with you can look at the work that you've done and it speaks to them in some way. We tried to do that with the Billboard Liberation Front. Now, although we weren't overtly political, we tried to make messages that would confuse people, but they would look at and go, well, look, someone made their own billboard. And then a good example of that would be the Exxon Valdez billboard that we did,
where a big bunch of oil was spilled into a bay in Alaska by Exxon Corporation. And we did billboards that said, shit happens, new Exxon. And I watched people walk by those billboards for hours in downtown San Francisco. And everyone who noticed the billboard, including people wearing expensive suits and people, working people, and a whole range of people, even a cop, they laughed at the billboard. They thought it was funny. Because instead of saying, fuck Exxon, which they would have looked at and go, look, a vandal did that. A vandal did that. That's terrible. They looked at it and they go, oh, yeah, Exxon. Oh, that's right. Oh, that's right. Exxon did sort of, yeah, okay, shit happens. I see. That's what Exxon thought about it. Like, so it was a way we hoped that would speak to someone. If you just talk to, I mean, politics, doing political, you know, stuff, I mean, if you're really angry, of course you want to be angry. I'm angry too, but if you constantly show that anger, you're going to alienate people. That you'll only make friends with people who are just as angry as you are, and then you'll all be angry together. You know, if you can't have fun as a prankster, the bad guys win. You know, if your life is terrible, that terrible, then they win, I think. So I think making a prank, and you have to be able to take a prank too, and if someone makes a joke on you, you can't get mad. You know, like, this, you know, it's not fair for you to get mad. So, but if you make pranks and you make fun of the powerful, you know, that's a way to do it. But you have to have fun doing it. You know, doing the billboards, we got to climb around on rooftops at night and sneak around places we weren't supposed to be. It was really fun, really exciting. And then we'd make a message, which people could take or leave as they like. So I don't know if that answers your question or not. But
yeah, no, it's cool. Thank you.
You were mentioning like Burning Man as being this place that corporation kids now go, but in a way, like the fact that they're using this place as a form of like alienation, a form of like resistance of their own reality, isn't it in a sense already sort of like political relevant? Like this idea that this place allows them to disrupt reality.
Well, it does. It allows them to disrupt reality for about 6 days. And if they as an individual take what they learned by disrupting reality for those 6 days and they do something else with it in the real world, then that's good. I don't see that much. I see some. There is some for sure. There are many people who do the creative work at Burning Man and take it. You know, if you go to Burning Man, it's a convention. You go there and you see other people doing interesting work. You learn from them, and then go home, go to Berlin, go to New York, and keep your work there, you know, where people really need it. Not out in the desert as an entertainment for rich kids, you know. Collaborate with the artists there, and collaborate with the creators there, and learn from them, and do something else. Do something you're not supposed to do.
I'd like to ask you, I participated, I think, 4 years ago, like, in Berlin, an event from the hedonists, and we had several points. We needed to go to McDonald's and search for vegetarian schnitzel, and also get dressed off in front of Kik, a discounter for cheap clothes. And it was a really funny thing, but at the end, why is it important to do stuff like that?
Did you do this?
I've been in the group. I mean, I didn't dress off, but we ran through the group and I participated in the other steps.
Yeah. Okay.
And we had a mobile sound system and we drove with a mobile sound system with a U-Bahn.
And okay.
At the end, we had the police following us.
Was it important to you?
It was interesting to disturb the other people and
you're
to
smiling.
Show up. Yeah, it was a really nice event. But at the end, it's the question, why is it important to do that?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I just asked you and you started talking about it and you smiled. So maybe it was a little important to you. I don't know. It's to each individual what they get out of it. You work together with other people to create something. And if something feels of value to you and it makes your life better, or you learn something from it, or you take it somewhere else, then I think that's important, sure. I think it's important.
So it mustn't be political at all. I mean, if you go to McDonald's and I'm asking for vegetarian food and go to the shop and just disturb the normal working processes, of course, there's something behind it. But
well, schnitzel's not vegetarian, right?
No, but the vegetarian schnitzel.
Yeah, okay. We had
a tofu schnitzel.
We had a thing called the vegetarian geek back in CUNY University. There was a fellow who did an event, and he called himself the vegetarian geek. A geek is a circus performer who would, back in the circus in America, usually they were alcoholics, and the only way they could make money was by being a geek, and they would bite the heads off of chickens and rats. So this fellow in CUNY University was a vegetarian geek. He would bite the heads off of carrots and cabbages. So I don't know if that was important or not, but I think he got something out of it.
Okay, thank you.
I think we have to go off the stage. Thank you, John.
Thank you. Thank you, Marie.